No, but there's a lot of buzzwords here. I think the first version of the slide deck was just about manifold learning and data visualization, but that's boring. Yeah, I mean, who want to do that, and for what reason? So that's why I put a bit more interesting stuff here. So whom of you did feature engineering already? Yeah, so that's good. And then data visualization, most probably almost everyone, right? Yeah, no, not yet. But in one way or the other, everything's visual. Yeah? So it's quite easy. And dimensionality reduction, that's a bit more involved, yeah, but still a lot. And manifold learning, so really like conscious. Yeah. Okay, so but we will change that. So basically you will see that it's not that complicated as it looks like, and it's much more complicated than you think. But that's basically the story of this talk. First, here, the simple part. So what is a manifold? Is there anyone here on the screen? No, not really. But there is like, yeah, you can think there is a manifold and we sampled some data points. That's basically, yeah, what we consider to be a manifold here today. In reality, so reality means for me in the mathematical world, basically, a manifold is somewhat involved concept in differential geometry. Actually, it's a topological concept, but what we mostly use is differentiable manifolds. So manifolds that are smooth in some sense. So smooth, basically, as you see it. So they're nicely curved and no edges or yeah, strange things that you cannot really visualize, but they happen all the time in the abstract mathematical setting. So essentially, it's some kind of smooth shape embedded in a higher dimensional space. And locally, yeah, I mean, yeah, I'm not really explaining what locally means, but if you just look at a small piece of it, then it looks like a flat space. The Euclidean space. And the Euclidean space is well known, so it's basically what we learn in school about mathematics, you know, triangles and yeah, the degrees in a triangle sum up to 180 degrees and so on. And so that's what we learn, Euclidean geometry. And that's what's basically behind this in the end. So that's making it useful. But useful is not only so for me in the mathematical world, I don't really care about usefulness because it's there, I can reason about it, I can do something with it, and that's useful enough. I can learn something. But in the real world, we need to solve problems or we need to describe real world objects, and yeah, that's what you can also do. And actually, this whole field of differential geometry, where the notion of manifolds comes from, is very useful. Yeah, I mean, it's actually the language where Einstein's general theory of relativity is written in, actually, and it's also you need it to describe black holes and what they're doing with space-time curvature and stuff like that. And there's also a very practical thing. It was heavily used in the proof of the Poincaré conjecture. Who knows Poincaré conjecture? Great. So then we don't go over it. It's no, it's also related to differential geometry. It's something about multidimensional spheres and yeah, how their topological properties are. And this is actually, of course, it's an abstract concept, but it has a lot of consequences in the real world. Not only that, for example, this whole relativity thing, but there is more. But what we want to use from this whole field, from the very complex field, is basically just the thing that it locally looks like Euclidean space. So locally, it's a flat space. We can do geometry. We can do calculus actually. Yeah, and calculus means we can, yeah, we can calculate derivatives, rate of changes, and stuff like that. And In principle, this is, yeah, what you mostly do with it. Yeah, but the level of abstractness or whatever you can call it, it goes a lot deeper because the whole topological thing, and we will touch this slightly. You will see it. But so this is I like it, and I had some lectures, but not my major subject. I like differential geometry, but there is not that much machine learning or manifold learning right now. So where is this learning? Yeah, we will come to that after we discuss a little bit more about what are these manifolds made of? So how can we describe them? Yeah, you've seen this S-shaped thing and the sphere with the hole inside, and so how can you describe that? So first thing, what is important is a so-called number of connected component. It's basically, is it one piece, two pieces, whatever. It's a very it seems to be a very simple concept, but we will later see how all these learning or visualization methods work, depending on the number of connected components. And of course, these things can have holes. They're not allowed to self-intersect, for example, because that's not Euclidean space anymore locally. If you have a crossing, that's not allowed. Yeah? So, but holes are OK. And of course, curvature, that's actually what you want, because most of the things in the real world have some curvature, not only space-time. And yeah, smoothness is important. Dimensionality, that's actually something that for everyone that works with data is also very important, the dimensionality of the data, whatever that means. Because typically we have some kind of a feature space, and then data is embedded, like you see here. But when you want to describe this S, for example, it's in a three-dimensional space, but it's essentially not a three-dimensional object, but just a two-dimensional shape. So dimensionality of the data would be two, dimensionality of the space three, but we can most probably represent this in a two-dimensional space somehow, yeah, without losing too much information. So, and of course there is more, and but we, yeah, and these concepts like holes and curvature and so this number of connected components, this is what topology deals with, yeah, and it's a very very general theory in mathematics, and you won't see it too often because it's you cannot touch it. Yeah, it's actually dealing with open sets. Who of you knows what an open set is? Yeah, okay, great. But then you most probably are mathematicians as well. Yeah, that's good. So, but now we somehow know what a manifold is, or at least no, we don't know what a manifold is, but we know some aspects or features that manifolds are having. Yeah, and you can, yeah, and I think it's easy to relate to that. Number of connected components, holes, curvature, that's something we all roughly understand. We don't need to define it more exactly here. But what we're in the end interested in, so when we work with data, we want to look at it somehow, yeah? We want to visualize it. And this means we need to also to understand what kind of properties should a good visualization have. And here is one presented, and that's a so-called Mercator projection of the Earth. And so who of you knows what a Mercator projection actually is? Ah, that's good. So then anyone wants to explain? Yeah, it's not that complicated. I mean, it's basically you take the ball of the Earth and you put it in a cylinder and then you project onto the surface of the cylinder, and then you roll it out. But there are strange things happening. For example, where is the South Pole? Yes, it's the line actually at the bottom. Yeah. So it's one point, and now became a line. So this is what happens when you project things from high-dimensional space in low-dimensional space. So definitely, so you could you definitely have lost something, or yeah, you made a point into a line. You can also say you could gain something. But what you also see, it's the so-called indicatrix. These orange circles, they indicate basically how the true sizes of the things on the surface of the Earth have changed now in the projection. So the larger the so basically the sizes should be all equal. Yeah, they represent equal spaces of area. So you can directly see that near the equator sizes are very very small, and the higher you get to the North Pole or South Pole, the larger the circles become. So the larger the area becomes. But what does it mean? Yeah. So I think we all are somehow used to this shape of the surface of the Earth. But is it the true shape? No, definitely not. And but before we look at the true shape of the Earth, yeah, in well. Of course, not a Mercator projection, but something else. But this indicates, so whatever we do with data, however we present it in two or three dimensions, we lose a lot, and also we construct a lot, and we put a lot into it. So this is not the Earth, but this is something that has been constructed by some mathematical technique called Mercator projection, and it's has very nice properties, but if you're not sailing the seas, you're most probably not that interested in. Yeah. So, but still, we use these things because for nautics, it was very, very helpful and important. So, but what actually is preserved here? So, definitely not the area. Area is not preserved. Yeah. But things like angles and orientations are somewhat preserved, and dimensionality is also preserved. It's also some same smoothness, I would say. Curvature, of course, is gone. Yeah, because now it's flat. Holes. Yeah, there are no holes, and connected components is actually just. That was not the. This Mercator projection is not dealing with connected components. It's not really transforming the data in such a way. But it's not so easy to decide whether, for example, the last point, so local or global properties, what are we interested in? Yeah? Are we interested in global properties of data? What was a global property? For example, the mean value of a set of numbers is a global property. Yeah? But local property is more like when you look at the distribution, so mean and max, that's more local, and so a number of points in a certain region, things like that. And here it's not that easy to determine what is kept and what not, but it's pretty clear that you cannot have it all, and that's actually the message. There's a lot more in these visualizations than you think, and they look reasonable at first glance, but here's actually. Here you see the difference, and actually I found this yesterday evening on LinkedIn. Yeah, it was a LinkedIn post, and it was actually a video zooming in and out between these two extremes. So the left one is area is preserved, and the right one is the Mercator projection that you know. And then you now look at the left side, and you think, okay, well, this is Europe, and this is the US, and yeah, which one would you prefer if you would live here? But if you're Africa or South America, yeah, which one, you might prefer different things, and that's so. Yeah, it's also even though it's it might be also it's funny to some degree, but it also shows some kind of ethnocentricity, if you like. Yeah, so and we use these cards because they're very nice to us. Yeah, they make us look greater than we are. So we in Europe, especially. So, but. That's why it's good to always have multiple perspectives on the same thing. Yeah, you always get you get the wrong impression if you just look at it from one angle. Yeah, and this maybe when you had this problem with defining intelligence. Yeah, that's one of the reasons why I don't really believe that one definition is sufficient. Yeah, you always have to combine multiple perspectives, and I think then you get a much clearer picture, or at least you get. You lose something, of course, because it's not unique, but you have at least, yeah, let's say, more of a overview of what it is contained, so a superset. So, but still, there's no learning, and I promised to do some learning here, and so let's discuss that. So what does learning mean? So what does learning mean in machine learning? Does anyone know? Or deep learning? What do you learn? Essentially, you just have some data, and then you learn some parameters in some whatever model, maybe neural network or just linear regression or whatever. So that's learning, finding some parameters. Is that sound not too good, right? But actually that's what it is. And here, I promise you, here it's a bit cooler. Actually, we learn more. Yeah? And so there is like three aspects of learning. Yeah? And the first one is dealing with this high-dimensional object. Yeah? When we do machine learning, we're typically not that interested in the high-dimensional object itself, but we want to do something with it. We want to either assign labels to the data points, and we don't really care like about the dimension of the feature set. That's the high-dimensional space, but we just care about is the output correct or not. And so that's a different perspective. So that's why we don't really need to learn this high-dimensional thing. But it turned out to be useful. That's what deep learning is actually doing. It tries to learn something about the high-dimensional thing. Yeah. And that's what we also do. We want to learn something about this manifold. What I've written down here, that's somewhat independent from the approximation problem that we want to solve, because in the end, in order to look at it, in order to make it useful, we need to have a low-dimensional approximation. Yeah, so that's always in the end for working with it, and doing something. We need to do that, but still, this first thing is independent. So that's why we can look at it from a very abstract perspective. for example, the perspective of manifolds. And the theories that we're using here in this manifold learning setting, they can be very complex. And I mean, if you're working with data science and machine learning, you're used to complexity, I would say. Yeah, you need to learn a lot of things: linear algebra, statistics, probability theory, computer science, some coding. Then most probably optimization theory and what else can be there. Yeah, for example, now here comes also differential geometry, but it's not stopping here. It's getting even worse, and I will show you what I mean with that. But still, it's worse in terms of complexity, but it's really interesting. And here also we need to, when we learn, we always have this question: do we want to learn something global or more local? And yeah, we have different notions of yeah, like the metrics. How do we measure things? Are we interested in distances or more in densities or neighborhoods or correlations and stuff like that? So, and these are the things that is more in the high dimensional space. So, and but you can also say, well, I don't really care about this high-dimensional thing. I just want my low-dimensional approximation or embedding, and I don't really care how I get there. And but whatever you want to approximate, you need to you need to measure basically the degree of approximation. So how far are you away from the original thing? So in one way or the other, you have this high-dimensional thing coming in. But you don't need to really learn something about it. You can just have some measure of distance, and then it's fine. So, and what you always have to do in the end is to have a mapping, yeah? Because you only have this high-dimensional thing, and you need to map it in the low-dimensional space. So whatever you do in the end is to have this mapping, and this mapping is the thing that has the parameters and all the stuff, and yeah, is allowing you to really calculate and compute this approximation. So. But all these things, whatever they do, they all use a lot of assumptions. So even though we are here in some kind of unsupervised learning setting, yeah, because there are no labels, it's just some data, and this forms a manifold and whatever, they all have some assumptions. And the more complex the theories are that we're using, the more implicit these assumptions become, because no one really understands what they're doing. But we can. But I hope I can show you in the end to some methods or techniques to try to, yeah, not really reveal these implicit assumptions, but to like have a sanity check. Is it sane what I'm doing here? Are the results probable or not? Or yeah, is it just a nice looking visualization and we all like nice pictures and so that's why we prefer them. So, but. Still, it's always good to keep that in mind, and to try to make these assumptions explicit is something that I strongly support. It's not always possible, not always easy, but I will show you. So that's actually the different notions of learning that we're doing, and it's different methods that we need to employ here. So, but whatever we do in the end, we need to we need to calculate that, and that's why there is this nice package scikit-learn in Python that has a lot of manifold learning algorithms already implemented. So you don't really need to care what it is, and it's like different. There's even more, but these are the things that I try to I want to say something about today. And I try to figure out what they actually preserve or what they try to preserve. So most of them have this idea of we want to locally approximate whatever it is. Yeah. So, and when you think about it, it's a reasonable idea. This manifold thing, it's somehow defined to be locally like Euclidean space. So locally, it's simple, it's flat. So we can describe it, and it's also from like it seems to be. Easier to preserve local structure than global structure. Yeah, it's not always true, but it's a good idea. So most of these embeddings, they work with some kind of neighborhood idea, and this isometry aspect. This is more about the scaling behavior. For example, multi-dimensional scaling. It's trying to scale all dimensions similar. And what is a very nice idea is a spectral embedding, because that's it's a very different approach. It's based on so-called Laplacian eigenmaps. So who of you knows what a Laplacian eigenmaps are? Ah, damn, there's still one left. Okay, but I'm very sure that there is one buzzword on this slide deck that you don't know. So, but in the end, in Laplacian eigenmaps, it's basically what you do is you take the data points and you construct a graph. Yeah? And then you do something with the graph structure, basically some kind of a spectral decomposition. Yeah? And there is a, and then, but in the end, it's all linear algebra. It's in the matrix, and you do some eigenvalue decomposition of a matrix, and that's it. Yeah? But the idea is great because it's transforming the problem into something else and applying this theory of spectral analysis. And yeah, that's very nice. So, and but there's one, I like to make things simple. So I like to speak about complex things and then making them simple because it makes me look very intelligent and so. And but still, in the end, that's actually the level of intelligence I can cope with. Yeah, that's this local tangent space alignment in a nutshell. Yeah, and what you see, it's like it's basically trying to unfold this shape in a proper way. And you also see that's not easy because there are many ways. I don't actually know how many, but I can calculate that in this kind of mapping. But the overall idea is that it's also one of these neighborhood methods, basically, yeah. Because it says when you have this high-dimensional object and you project it down in a two-dimensional space, then you assume that these tangent spaces, so each manifold, if it's locally some smooth thing, then you can have a tangent, you know, it's like something that touches it, and tangent space is just like a plane, hyperplane that's touching this manifold, and these hyperplanes are somewhat aligned, and the alignment is what you can see here in the two-dimensional projection. So yeah, and this is what it's doing. And it's, of course, in real time, it's much more complicated, but this is like, you can imagine what how it looks like. So, but there's more. There was also this dimensionality reduction thing in my title. And what there's also, and these methods are also in scikit-learn, so principal component analysis, I think most of you have done it one way or the other, or singular value decomposition, so that's something well known. It's actually also a manifold learning method because it just says, well, I want to find the best approximating linear subspace. And linear subspaces, I mean, they're open sets, of course, trivial manifolds, clear. Yeah, so that's also something, but it's not the kind of manifold that we typically think of, and it has some nice properties because it's a deterministic procedure. It tries to preserve the variance in the data point, so we cannot here choose like correlation or distance or whatever. It just preserves the variance of the in the data, and it comes with a best approximation guarantee. So it's really giving you the best linear subspace of a certain dimension. So you cannot do better given the restrictions of this method. Yeah, and it's not only that; it actually solves multiple problems at the same time because you can first just compute, not a principal component analysis in the terms of approximation, but you can just compute the transformation in the high-dimensional space and then decide, depending on the singular values that you get out of it. Yeah, so how much error are you willing to accept? So you can truncate to a certain dimension and respect a certain error bound with respect to the variance, for example. So that's very nice because I'm coming from mathematical optimization and there's a lot about errors and stuff like that, and we want to control that, and that's a good method. So, but it's linear, and linear things typically are too simple for the non-linearities in the real world. So that's why there are other methods, and these methods are very funny actually because they don't do any learning at all. It's just a random projection. And it's one of the great things about mathematics, that the simple things sometimes have astonishing properties. Who of you knows these Gaussian and sparse random projection stuff? Ah, great. So there's a theory behind it, actually, and that says if I have data in a very high-dimensional space, yeah, then I can I just randomly project this into a space of much lower dimension without losing, the distances. So basically keeping the distance almost exactly the same. And you can actually calculate the dimension to which you can basically project down, yeah, based on this Johnson-Lindenstrauss lemma. It's a very conservative estimate, but still it's not very useful because it says if you have a space of like dimension 100,000, then you can maybe project into like 3,000 dimensional space, yeah, which is not that low, like 2 or 3 that you want to have. But still, what you can do is, or what we know is, that still these things, even if you project it into 2 or 3 dimensional space, it still somehow almost optimally approximates the distances. Yeah, And that's this—that's the funny power of randomness. It's really great. And the only thing is, basically, you have some certain ways how to generate these random projection matrices. They need to be orthogonal projections and so on. But you will see them later. Hopefully, I'm not talking too much, so I can show you the things. But this is the complete opposite of learning, actually, because it just says I randomly generate this mapping. And then I just project the thing from high dim to low dim, and I don't even care about the data. I just create this mapping, and still this works. You will see how it works. I will not promise too much. So, but now the cool stuff, the mathematical stuff, advanced methods. I like advanced because it's better than simple. And you need to, it shows that I'm master of advanced methods, and maybe I will be professor next year. I have a good feeling. There are two methods that are becoming more and more popular. The first one is the so-called T-distributed stochastic neighbor embedding. It has very nice properties. I try to write down some properties of what's interesting here and what is it actually doing. And yeah, the first thing, it's not trying to preserve distances or stuff like that. It's trying to preserve something completely different. Yeah, it just says, okay, if you're a point here and then you have some neighbors, and if I embed you now in low dimensional space, you most probably want to have the same neighbors. Yeah, so it's conservative if you want, no change. You want to have the same thing that you know in low and high dimensional space, and this is what this thing is doing. It estimates basically conditional probabilities for your neighborhood and then tries to preserve these. And the tool that it's using, it just has a funny name, Kullback-Leibler divergence. That's just how you measure the difference between these probability distributions. Yeah, it's of course it's complicated when you want to really know the theory behind. But you will see how it works. It's just good to know that it's doing something completely different. So whatever you see in the end, distances do not matter, angles do not matter. It's just the final representation is. Even though it's then printed in 2 or 3D, it looks like Euclidean space. It's not. It's actually some. Yeah, it's not that clear. There is a link that tries to explain what it's doing in behind and what you can take out of it. So distances do not matter in the sense of you can really take like a distance of 2 has something as a meaning and distance of 1 is smaller. That's not, but of course distances mean something, they are separated, they are not in the same neighborhood actually. Yeah. So and then there is a completely different thing, and this is this UMAP, or Uniform Manifold Approximation and Projection, and it's based on something completely different. So I think most mathematicians don't touch these two fields during their studies, because they're really separated and typically, if you like the first one, so all the statistics and probability stuff, then you don't like the second one. So I prefer the second one, don't like the first one. But even though it's completely two different worlds, differential geometry and even worse, algebraic topology. Who has had a lecture on algebraic topology? Really? Damn, you have one more than I have. And you also? Great. So did you like it? Yeah. Yeah. But it's interesting, let's say. And to help you a bit with what it really preserves, I wrote down it preserves important structural properties. And that's good. We all want important properties to be kept. And it's not that easy to say what they actually are. So what is this thing doing? It's in the world of differential geometry and algebraic topology, things are a bit, they don't look the same as we are used to. So essentially, it's trying to do this fuzzy topological representation via some simplices. So I cannot really explain what it, because it has a well-defined meaning in mathematics, and whatever I can say about this is most probably wrong. But these are basically the, you need to know a lot more about category theory, functors, and this topological representation stuff than I know in order to understand what they're doing. I read the original paper, and it's, and then I need to read some more textbooks in order to understand the rest. But yeah. But the funny thing is, the visualization it creates are very, very similar to the one that the Teesney algorithm is creating. So, and Yeah, so, and after all this talking and stuff, I would like to come to a demo, because words are not enough to describe what we're doing, and that's why we're coding most of the time. And even though I'm a mathematician by training, I hopefully also know a bit about, where is it? No, other way? Yeah, great. So, I know a bit about programming as well, maybe. So, and what you see is that it's too large. So the good thing is, scikit-learn comes with a very nice documentation, and you can copy-paste. Oh, I can copy-paste. So sorry. You can program, but I can copy-paste much better than this thing. And so I took what is there and created some examples. Let me just run this thing first. So what are we doing here? So we have in this scikit-learn, we have manifolds. We have this manifold package and datasets. And in my slide deck, there were datasets already. And here is also the first dataset that you want to operate with. So it's this S curve. And why is this S curve interesting? Yeah, because there's actually not really a good way to embed this into to project this to a two-dimensional space, because you always lose something. Yeah, you can you get either the S or you get some flat thing. But we will see what these different methods are doing. And so all these manifold learning methods, they come with a lot of parameters. And I will not explain what they're really doing. But I will show you what they do with the S curve. So. And the first thing that you notice is that you won't see any S. So why is that? Of course, I mentioned this thing with local and global properties. So what is S? The S shape is a global property, yeah. And when we look at this S, yeah, for us it makes sense globally. But locally, it looks much more like this one here. And this local linear embedding says, well, no, locally it's just curved. There is some curvature, and that's why I plot it that way. Yeah, and the other methods, they are doing something else. So, for example, it's more like they're taking this S and then putting it to a flat flat thing. But I did also it changed some parameters in order to show you some other results. So here it's now, when you change the parameter setting, it's the very same method, it's just a tiny change in the code, because they internally, most of these methods are doing some kind of principal component approximation beforehand. And so even though we are just in three dimensions and plotting to two dimensions, it's, this approximation makes a difference. And now you still see, so for example, you still see that this local linear embedding shows you the curvature. Yeah? So that's one perspective, one way to look at the S. This multidimensional scaling shows you the S. So it's looking from a different perspective. These other ones here, this local tangent space alignment, for example, it's now just having this flat. So because it's just this S, it's just in the end, a rectangle, yeah, just a little bit deformed rectangle, yeah, and the others are showing similar stuff. And here's also this T-SNE. The T-SNE has always some kind of some kind of substructure. It looks a bit interesting. And what you also will notice here, this T-SNE is one of the advanced methods. It's taking much longer than the others. For example, the spectral embedding, it's super fast, and T-SNE is orders of magnitude slower. Yeah, so these methods are more complex, but they are way more expensive. And if you want to be, if you want to work fast and efficient with your resources, then you should use this very carefully and with low dimensional, with small samples of your data, and not just using it with 10,000 data points. Here's just 500 points. So it's not that much. 500 points in three dimensions. Yeah, so it's really tiny data. So, but there is these other methods like random projections, and random projections are even way more faster. You see even orders of magnitudes faster than the fastest methods from this manifold learning stuff. And what can you see? Do you like it? That's random projection. That's really the, like the, you don't need any degree in math or even school to understand what's going on here. But it's it makes a lot of sense, and it's beautiful as well. Yeah, I like it. So it's useful, and it shows that even the very simple methods can help. And this is what the principal component analysis is looking like. And yeah. Again, here, if we would tweak this S curve a bit, yeah, so scale the dimensions a bit, yeah, because this thing tries to preserve variance. Now this looks, we think, well, it's great, it looks good, because we see our global shape S is preserved. But the principal component analysis does not care about the S shape; it just cares about variance. And this S is just a bit, yeah, it has more variance in this direction than in the other direction. So if we would scale it a bit, then we would just see these something like that. Here, yeah. So, and that's actually also one of the problems when doing data visualization. You implicitly always want to make sense out of it, yeah. And that's something dangerous, because the things that we think make sense are very, very, yeah. It's just a tiny subset of the things that really make sense. And I know what I'm speaking about, because I'm a lot of I created a lot of visualizations in my professional career, and it happened very, very often to me that I just fall in love with something that I created, and it just because it was good looking, and yeah, and then you invent a story around this and say, well, it looks good, so now I need to figure out why it makes sense, yeah, and that's of course not scientific, yeah. So if you want to do this kind of stuff and still have a yeah, proper scientific approach to it, then you should be neutral to your own actions, and it's not that easy. So now I did something, a minor change to this S-curve. I just shifted I cut it in the middle and yeah, shifted the upper half of the S a bit down. So now we have no longer one manifold, but two. It's two connected components, yeah? And let's see what our algorithms are doing. So do you expect any major changes? Do you have any expectations at all? I don't know, but you will see. So now this is what it looks like. So, and here's the thing about these implicit assumptions. So most probably you would not have expected something like that. So what happens here? Yeah, these methods here, they collapse because they implicitly assume that there is one manifold and not two, or two connected components. Yeah. So, but if you have a high-dimensional data set and you know not really much about it, yeah, then most probably there are some clusters or some local structures, so not just one connected component. So yeah, it's not that easy to use these methods if you don't know much about your data. Yeah, this one here looks pretty good actually. I like it, but it makes no sense at all. Yeah, but it's, again, it looks like, oh man, there must be meaning behind it. It's not. And the other methods, yeah, it's not really clear. It's not easy to say which one is a good visualization actually. Yeah, because but I again do this small parameter tweak and. In order to show you something, at least this multi-dimensional scaling, this actually does not care about number of connected components, and also this t-SNE is giving some reasonable results. Yeah, it actually shows you something that is already in the data. Because, for example, what's the problem with this one here? Yeah, you will never think that this high-dimensional object is disconnected. Yeah. And that's why it's completely wrong. Yeah. So, and again, we can try the same with this random projections, and they are very good because they also don't care about the data. It's funny, but it works. And PCA, it's also looking as usual. And here, so I wanted to show you UMAP, and yeah, this is what UMAP is looking like. And so, what do you think? Is it reasonable or not? Of course it's not, because I made a small change, because when you just do the standard whatever, go to the documentation, it starts with some metric as a correlation. And correlation makes no sense here. We want to have Euclidean distance, and once you choose that, then you also get a reasonable representation. Yeah, and it's actually, it's even though it's a it's looking different, but it's still when you look to the t-SNE variant, it's very similar to that one, even though it's a completely different theoretical approach to the world, and the objects in it. Yeah, I think I need to go to this one just to show you what can go wrong. I'm actually a fan of everything that can go wrong, because there's so much that can go wrong. And so that's why I have this example for you. It's random noise. Why do we want to visualize random noise? Yeah, because it's a good sanity check. Yeah, if you have a method that takes random noise and shows you something, then it's most probably not a good idea, and we will check that. So as a baseline, we will look at PCA, Gaussian, and sparse random projection, and you see something like confetti. And that's okay, because it is. It's not much that you see. So let's look at this t-SNE. So, and this is what you have to know. This is the t-SNE version of random noise. Yeah, but it's definitely looking like structure, even though there is no structure. But that's basically the inbuilt assumption into t-SNE. It tries to collapse neighbors into clusters. Yeah? And of course, also in random noise, there are some small deviations in density and so on. So there are small clusters, but it's not real structure. And when we do the same with UMAP, then we get this. But it's again, I think it's again the, I have again this correlation thing. And when we change it to Euclidean, was it that or was it? Or was it lower, higher case? So if we change it to Euclidean, then we see that UMAP seems to make way more sense. So and it's also faster than t-SNE. So I think actually this is the, it's a more promising method, but, yeah, it's still a but. t-SNE, I understand a bit about it, but UMAP, I really don't know what the thing is doing internally. But, yeah, so that's, but it passed this one sanity check, which is good. And also, the last one, I promised to tell you something about feature engineering. So how can we make this can we make use of this in the field of machine learning? And that's why I created a completely artificial toy example, a classification problem about the digits data set that's already coming with scikit-learn. And I trained some classifiers, KNN and logistic regression, and they're already very good. Yeah, so almost 98% accuracy and 95% accuracy and so on. So and it's just making 16 errors out of these 719 here, so it's very good. But still, when we use this, the method that I shown you as like to auto-generate features, yeah, just take the high-dimensional data, project it into low-dimensional space, take this as features, add this to your original features, and what you can get out of it, you can even get better. And you don't need to put anything into it. Yeah, there's no feature engineering, as you know. It's just use a method, get some features, put it together, and it's a bit better. Of course, logistic regression is a bit worse, but it doesn't matter. We can improve here if we add all the manifold. Oh no, that's a training error. Doesn't matter. So here, but here now, okay. That's just another sanity check. So what if we just add random vectors? Yeah, and you see, random vectors actually decrease the score. Yeah, so that's also good to know that. Adding random things is not helping, but it's also, I'm a fan of the sanity checking. And here, we now put a lot of these different methods together. It's like sparse and Gaussian, this multidimensional scaling, t-SNE also, yeah, but I know I omitted it here, I think, and because it takes so long to compute. And no, I have it here, and then there's an error. Oh, let me just uncomment this, damn, I need to do it. No, I forgot that one. So then you see that it's actually really, I mean, of course, it's a toy problem. Yeah, and it's not always working. It took me some time. But that's how science works. Yeah, you work as as hard and as long as you get results. And that's actually what is done here. Sorry for the waiting time. That's the runtime of t-SNE. It's a bit too long. For my opinion, oh, again, it's a damn. What's the problem here? There's one more line to uncomment. Ah, oh, this one here. Oh, damn. Yeah, that's the copy paste. Another one. Still. the transformer. Oh no, it's not. Oh, I hate it. Yeah, fun with notebooks. So I think it should take 20 seconds or so. I'm sorry for the delay. But the good thing is you don't have time for asking me something, so I don't need to show all my incompetence afterwards. So we can end with this almost perfect classification result. And this is just by doing automated feature engineering. Hopefully it works, because it's not so easy to find the right random seed for. No, it's just joking. But in the end, it's of course, it's just a toy problem. You see this a lot on Kaggle, actually. People trying to automate feature engineering, or just to increase the feature set, because when you have much smarter methods like XGBoost or like tree-based methods, they can work with the feature sets much more clever than these very simple algorithms. K-nearest neighbors and logistic regression are a bit stupid, actually. But what's the problem? Is it taking that long? Yeah, I'm sorry. I cannot show you, but it was better, I promise. I think we need to stop here, but it was 98 something percent. It was just 12 errors, so we got rid of 4 additional errors, yeah, just by adding no intelligence. And that's actually what I want you to do in the future. Add a lot more of no intelligence to your machine learning pipelines. Use manifold learning as much as you can, even though it's complicated, and don't be afraid of all the stuff that's in there. And I hope the interesting pictures and maybe also the good classification results will be rewarding for you in the end. So thanks a lot.